Bob, suicide, of course, has always been with us. It's always been an issue. But are we addressing it differently now than we did 5, 10, 15 years ago?
We are. And the major thing that's changed is we're talking about it as a society, as a public. It's in pop culture in some ways, which years ago no one would talk about it. It was swept under the carpet. If a family experienced it, they wouldn't talk about it. So the other thing is we've learned a lot from research. We need to learn a lot more, but we have learned a lot. Most people who have a mental health condition don't become suicidal. So what's different in those individuals who do?
Exactly.
And there's actually starting to be treatments that work very well with suicidal patients.
We've had some terrible celebrity deaths by suicide. What has that done? Has that gotten people to reach out more, to be more aware?
It has. I think that unlike in the past, when there was a high-profile suicide, a lot of the media coverage talked about methods and focused on why a person with so much to live for would do this, and kind of almost blaming the person. In the recent celebrity deaths, we saw much better media coverage looking for reasons why, what people can do, encouraging people to seek help, offering resources like the Lifeline and the Crisis Text Line. And so that's a positive trend, and we want to keep encouraging that.
So tell me about the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention.
We invest in research. We're actually the largest private funder of research in the world. And we fund, now we have about 18 million in current studies. They run the gamut from genetic studies and understanding genetic factors, biological studies. Research is really important. We need to know more so we can do a better job in prevention.
What are the triggers?
Well, suicide is complex. And so while you may have an underlying mental health condition, often it's kind of almost the perfect storm where the person has depression or a substance problem or both, but also has life kind of stresses and situations that pile on. So financial problems, relationship problems, it becomes overwhelming and they spiral into hopelessness. And hopelessness is the biggest factor.
So how do we break the stigma and encourage everyone who's feeling down to seek help?
Well, part of it is we have to be more mental health literate as a society. Mm-hmm. If we see things in our loved ones and our friends and our coworkers and so on, if we see things that don't seem right, we need to ask them about that. Are you okay? And be good listeners, not be judgmental, but just try to understand what's going on, you know?
And it's okay to ask.
It's absolutely okay.
Because you used to think, don't ask, don't talk about it.
And listen to them. You know, don't be judgmental. I think that's where a lot of people go wrong. You know, oh, you're fine. What are you doing? You know, but to really listen to their answers. And what we have found is that people do open up and admit that they're having those thoughts. You're not going to put the thought in their head. That's a myth. And so it's actually very, very important to ask.
Now, on your website, it's very easy to navigate, it's easy to get answers, but you highlight a number of things. One is finding better ways to prevent suicide, bringing hope to those affected by suicide, and creating a culture that's smarter about mental health. How are you doing that?
So each of those things are important and work together. There's things we know work. Cognitive behavioral therapy works really well with suicidal patients. There's something called safety planning that's showing great promise in terms of clinicians learning how to talk with the client about what will keep you safe. Who will you call if you're having a crisis? One of the most important things we know from research is to separate a suicidal person from the means by which to take their life. And, you know, in the U.S., well, in the U.S., 50% of those who die by suicide take their life using a firearm. So firearm safety and education about suicide risk is a really important part of the work we're doing.
So you're saying family members need the means to be able to take the weapon away. Are you talking about legally, or are you talking about just take it away and lock it in a drawer somewhere?
No, we're talking about being educated about what to look for. You got to know first there's a problem. And if you own a firearm, you should be sure to keep it safely stored, locked away and unloaded, so a person who's at risk can't get access to it. And in some places, in some states, you can legally give it to someone else to hold temporarily. This is not a Second Amendment issue. This is a safety issue. And we're actually working with the firearms community, retailers and so on, to educate them about suicide risk.
If you can stop it from being that impulsive act.
Yes.
Where there's a gun in the next room.
Yes. And, you know, people may be thinking about it for a while, but it's a step to actually making an attempt. And so that's why these means efforts really do help.
What do you think is going to happen next 5 to 10 years? What improvements?
Well, I can tell you what we want to happen. We want to bring the suicide rate down in the U.S. We've set a goal as an organization to try to bring the rate down, suicide rate down, 20% by 2025. I mean, we can't do it alone. You know, we're one organization. We need to get partners and other groups to join with us in taking that on as a national agenda and a national goal. And it's starting to happen, which is great to see.
Can that happen?
I think it can. Now, it's not easy. It's been trending up, as I said. We have to reverse the curve, bring it down. Mm-hmm. But I think we're ready. We know enough. We have enough people engaged. Again, the families affected, speaking out in ways and numbers we've never seen before. And we have strategies, we know they work, but they're not being done on a scale that's affecting the suicide rate. A good example, 39% of those who die by suicide have been seen in an emergency department within the past 12 months. If I go in with chest pains, they know what to do to make sure that I stay alive and then get the help, right? Get the treatment that's called for. Same thing can happen with this. To figure out better strategies for what to do when someone presents in the emergency department, that's a gap. If we can close it, we'll save lives. And I think it will eventually bring down the rate. So I'm optimistic we can do it, but there's a lot of work to be done, and we need lots of partners and groups to join with us on this.
I wish you all the luck. We certainly need it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.